नेक्स्ट स्पीकर इज डॉक्टर दिलीप कुमार फ्रॉम यूनिवर्सिटी ऑफ केरला. बट बिफोर ही टेक्स ओवर द नेक्स्ट सेशन आई वुड लाइक टू मेक अ नोट हियर. इफ आई गो बैक टू द टाइम व्हेन आई स्टार्टेड माय पीएचडी, द वन थिंग आई रिमेंबर स्पेसिफिकली विच आई रिमेंबर टिल डे is the 1 month long summer school in Kerala, specifically on fractional calculus. Professor Mathai, Professor Mainardi, and of course, Dr. Dilip Kumar sir have mentored all the 30 participants, I was one among them, to understand the nature, to understand the beauty of fractional order derivatives. Thank you so much, sir. And the next session will be conducted by you. So please share your screen and embrace the audience, sir. Dilip, sir, can you hear me? You can unmute
yourself. Yes, thank you. Thank you very much, Neelam, for your wonderful introduction. Very nice to hear that you are organizing a conference on or webinar on fractional calculus, which is an upcoming or emerging area of mathematics. And I feel that, in fact, there should be more researchers coming to this fractional calculus area, so that we will have a good background and we will have a strong contribution to the society in the area of fractional calculus. So before starting my talk, let me share my screen. Is it by sharing that tray desktop? Is it that by the desktop
yes.
window?
Okay. Yes.
Okay. Let me try. Okay. I got it. Can you see my screen?
Yes, sir.
It's a PDF.
Yes, sir.
Okay. I hope I'm audible also.
Yes, sir. Definitely, sir.
Okay. Good afternoon, participants. And myself, before introducing my talk, let me give a brief idea about myself. I am Dr. Dilip Kumar from University of Kerala, working as an assistant professor in the Department of Mathematics. And my area of specialization is special functions, especially special functions, then fractional calculus, integral transforms, as well as reaction rate theory in astrophysics. So in present talk, what I am planning is to give a brief idea about the fractional calculus as well as its connections with the special functions and how it works when we do our research work. Okay, so in any talk, when I used to start my talk with a saying from a great mathematician, Dr. Srinivas Ramanujan, that an equation for me has no meaning unless it expresses a thought of God. This quote has always inspired me while I was doing my research, because there should be some worth. If we are doing some research work, there should be some worth that it should be useful for the mankind. That is what I understand from this quote of this great mathematician. Obviously, we celebrate the National Maths Day on December 22nd in his memory, to celebrate his birthday. And we are fortunate that today is a day birthday of Mr. Ludwig Seilhaus also. Actually, he is a great mathematician who worked in abstract algebra or in group theory, finite group theory. I hope you remember him also. And to become a great mathematician, it is inevitable to respect all mathematicians so that we can also contribute something to the society. So with this, let us start our talk. And in this talk, what I will be giving, initially I thought that to give a brief idea about the fractional calculus, but Gangaram sir has already given a nice exposition of the fractional derivatives and fractional integrals, and he has given a nice introduction about the topic. So I will be just giving an idea about that, and as well as I will introduce various fractional operators which you are seeing or you can study, where very good scope is there on these fractional operators, and still open problems are there, and people can work on these areas. And then I will be giving an explanation how we can use these fractional operators on some particular areas, like suppose you are having a generalized function, and how you use a fractional operator on that particular function to generalize, to obtain new results. So this will be another interesting thing which I will be explaining. And later I will be explaining one more thing, this P transform, which was introduced by myself in 2011, and I will be showing how this transforms and fractional operators are related, or how can we relate these fractional operators as well as these transforms. First I will explain the generalized transforms, the generalized functions, how these generalized functions are related to fractional operators, and then I will show how generalized transforms are related to fractional operators, and later I will show how these results, which these all these generalized Kurzweil functions and p-transforms were derived by myself, and generalized Kurzweil function was derived by myself and Kilbas in the year 2008, and 2009, and this p-transform was developed in 2011. And finally, I will just try to explain the application of this thing in astrophysics, how these results were related to astrophysics or reaction rate theory in astrophysics. This is what my plan is. So before we start, I just have a brief idea about what is fractional calculus. Fractional calculus deals with the derivatives and integrals of arbitrary order. That is what for sure you have understood by this previous two lectures. And we know what is the ordinary derivative and what is ordinary integral means, because you are studying it from the graduation or even from the higher secondary onwards. And when it comes to fractional, we can consider the non-negative integers as well as positive fractions, negative integers, negative fractions, or even complex numbers. So when you consider d raised to alpha y by dx raised to alpha, where alpha can be an arbitrary order, we call generally it as a fractional derivative. So this is what we usually call the fractional derivative is. Now, how it originated, it is by L'Hopital. Once L'Hopital had a doubt, what will be alpha equal to or n equal to 1 by 2? What will happen when n is equal to 1 by 2? Or what is the meaning of that d ratio n y by dx ratio n when n is equal to 1 by 2? And he wrote a letter to Leibniz. And in 1695, Leibniz gave a reply saying that it will be an apparent paradox from which useful consequences can be drawn one day. And from that day, later, Euler had some work on this area, but more or less, this fractional calculus was dormant for several decades. So after that, only in the past few decades, again, fractional calculus had some came into the limelight of research, and many results were produced in these years. So actually, I presume that this fractional calculus, the name fractional calculus, has been originated by originated from the question, the primary question, that n is equal to half. Excuse me. Hello.
Yes, sir.
Am I audible? Is there any problem?
Yes. Yes, sir. I am going to mute every participant. Okay. After a second, you can unmute yourself.
Okay.
So now you can unmute yourself and continue with the session. So please unmute yourself and continue with the session.
Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Okay, okay. So can you see my screen also?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Okay. So I presume that the name fractional calculus came by the primary question, what if n equal to half? And we have found many applications for fractional calculus in recent years, and including the fluid flow, rheology, reaction diffusion, relaxation, oscillation, anomalous diffusion, reaction diffusion, turbulence, electric network, physics, chemistry, waves, dynamical problems, fractals, and recently in statistical distribution theory also. So one of the main advantage, or we call it as a disadvantage, is that fractional calculus or fractional derivative in some sense, fractional derivatives and fractional integrals have many definitions. That is somewhat we can say that there is this, it will sometimes it will be a drawback of the subject of fractional calculus. So in this talk, what I am planning is to give a unified definition for fractional calculus so that it can be used in many areas with a single definition, or with the same definition we can interpret the derivatives. That is what my plan is. Okay, so usually we know that d raised to n is d raised to n by dx raised to n for n equal to 0, 1, 2, 3, etc. is an integer order derivative. That is for sure, you know, all of you know that. And if you put, if you replace n by alpha, you get, and where alpha is a non-negative integer or fraction or complex number, we get a fractional order derivative. And if you take the nth order multiple integral or n-fold integral or antiderivative, we usually write it as d raised to minus n. And for derivative, we used to write d raised to n. This is the conventional way of writing. Okay. Now, what I am planning is to give an intuitive interpretation of fractional integral as a fraction of the total integral of the two types that we usually study on the left-sided and as well as the right-sided fractional integral or derivative. And the same way, or left-sided or first kind or second kind of fractional integrals like that. So we will give a brief introduction to this intuitive definition. Okay, this is this definition actually was given by Mathai in 2013, 14, and 15 papers. So for that, let us consider a simplex or an area B minus a square area. I hope you can see my mouse moving. So B minus A times B minus A. The square part is this one. And let us consider a line X1 equal to X2. This is that line. And this X, the point X is actually moving. This point, this line as well as this line is actually a moving lines. So now we have two parts. This one simplex left on the left side and the other simplex on the right side. So first let us consider the left side of the line X1 equal to X2. And we will also consider the area on the right side of this line, that right side of this line X1 equal to X2. Now let us see what is the area of this triangle. So for this triangle, you could see that what is the area of this triangle. If you find the area by integration, you can see that it is from X1 equal to A to X1 equal to X. To A to X, so X1, the limit of X1 will be A to X, and the limit of X2 will be X1 to X. It will be X1 to X. So this area will be integral A to X and integral X1 to X dx, dx1 as well as dx2. So that what, that is what we get here. So the area, if we consider a two-dimensional area, the like this. Here we have considered a two-dimensional or two space, an area in two space. Okay. So here what you will get is the integral x1 equal to a to x dx1 and integral x2 equal to x1 to x dx2. And when you integrate this part, what you are getting is integral x1 equal to a to x, x minus x1 dx1. This is the case when we are considering a two space. Now, if you are considering a three space, that is a three-dimensional volume space, what you will get? You will get this direction, horizontal direction, vertical direction, as well as the height direction in the upper direction also. So the three parts we have to consider. So here we will be having x1 will move from a to x dx1, x2 will go from x1 to x dx2, and integral x3 will move from x2 to x. So this will be the integral. And finally, when you integrate this, what you are getting is integral x1 equal to a to x, x minus x1 the whole squared by 2 factorial dx1. Now, in this way, if you consider an n-fold space or n space, if you consider an n space, you will get an n-fold integral like this. Here, you are getting for a two space, you are getting a double integral, and you are getting this function, this integral. And for a triple three space, we are getting the function like the integral x1 equal to a to x. Here also integral x1 equal to a to x, x minus x1 whole square by 2 factorial dx1. And if you consider an n space, in this way, if you proceed, what you will get is integral x1 equal to a to x, x minus x1 raised to n minus 1 by n minus 1 factorial dx1. This is what we are going to get in n space. Now here, we have only considered the line x1 equal to x2. Instead of this, if you consider a function, if you consider a function to find the area, you are having a function or you are having a curve and you are going to find the area with respect to that, what you are going to get, that is, if you are integrating out a function of x1 alone, then you are going to get an integral like this, integral x1 equal to a to x, x minus x1 raised to n minus 1 by n minus 1 factorial f of x1 dx1. Now this n minus 1 factorial, in case of integers, it is fine. But in case of a rational number or a fraction or any other complex number, we cannot put in the terms of a factorial, and we move it to the gamma notation or gamma function, where gamma function is defined as integral 0 to infinity t raised to z minus 1 e raised to minus t dt. The real part of z is greater than 0. So here, this, in this form, we can consider any order. That means not even n equal to 0, 1, 2, 3, etc. Instead, you can take 0.5 or 2.5 or minus 2 or 2 plus 3i or whatever it be, you can take here, and you will get the area according to that. And this is actually what we call is the left-sided integral, and we usually denote it as like this, a dx raised to minus alpha f of t, the integral over the left simplex in n space. And thus, this is the basic definition of the Riemann-Lovell fractional integral. We are coming up to the Riemann-Lovell fractional integral by this, and we will get 1 by gamma of alpha integral t equal to a to x, x minus t raised to alpha minus 1 f of t dt, where real part of alpha is greater than 0. And there is one more notation, di minus alpha is also there. Usually we use that alpha I minus alpha plus, and I plus alpha is also there. So instead of minus, we use plus and minus with the notation I. In some textbooks, they use that definition. Okay, so thus the corresponding fractional derivative, if this is minus, for the derivative part, what we use is a dx raised to alpha f of t. Instead of, this is integral, so for the derivative, we call it as a dx alpha f of t. Okay, Now let us similarly for this is for the left hand side, left sided Riemann Lovell fractional integral, and for the right sided Riemann Lovell fractional integral, we again have to consider the same triangle on the right side. Here what happens is we will have to take the area from x to b as well as x to x1. So x1 will vary from x to b and x2 will vary from x to x1. So that is what we have to use. So in that case, what you will get is integral x1 equal to x to b dx1, integral x2 equal to x to x1 dx2, and you will get this. And corresponding in three space, you will be getting is integral x to b x1 minus x the whole square by 2 factorial dx1. This bracket is an extra one, so it's a wrong, it's a mistake, typing mistake. Sorry for that. So thus, for an n space, what you are going to get is integral x1 equal to x to b x1 minus x raised to n minus 1 gamma of n dx1. And if you consider, as in the previous case, if you consider a function of x1 alone, what you are going to get is the right sided Riemann Lovell fractional integral. So that we will be getting this x to b dx db minus alpha f of t, which is integral x to b t minus x raised to n minus 1 gamma of n f of t dt. Because its x is actually varying. So here x varies, and actually this will go for this general value t. And thus we are going to get the right sided Riemann Lovell fractional integral of order alpha in this form given in equation 2. So this is the basic idea behind the Riemann Lovell fractional integral or fractional derivative. Very close to this Riemann Lovell fractional derivative and integral, we have a Weyl fractional integral in where we use, instead of this a, we use minus infinity to x. So this minus infinity to x minus 1 by gamma of alpha integral minus infinity to x minus t raised to alpha minus 1 f of t dt. Why we use Weyl fraction? It is actually in practical cases, this is more useful than this Riemann Lovell. That is why Weyl fractional integral has much more importance. So that is why I mentioned it here. We also use the same thing as for practical purposes, minus infinity to x is comes more handy. And for the right sided Weyl fractional integral of order alpha, we have 1 by gamma of alpha integral x to infinity t minus x raised whole raised to alpha minus 1 f of t dt, real part of alpha greater than 0. And the fractional derivative in this case will be minus d by dx whole raised to n I minus n minus alpha. This is the same notation as in the previous case, that what we are using, that Riemann Lovell fractional integral. So this is another definition for the same thing. So by this, there are various other fractional operators which we use in our research work. In fact, so many fractional operators or fractional integral operators are developed in recent few decades. And one of the prominent among them is the Kober fractional integral as well as Zygo fractional integrals. So let me give an idea about that also. This equation 4 is the left-sided Kober fractional integral, and this can be seen in the books of Edley and Kober jointly introduced this, and it's available in the book of this the book of integral transforms. You can see that in that book you can see this Kober operators, and 4 and 5 are the left and right side Kober fractional integrals. Now, just before I said about the fractional, Zygo fractional operators, this is the equation 6 and 7 are the psigo fractional integral operators. Left sided, this one is a left sided equation 6 is a left sided fractional integral operator, and this one is a right sided fractional operator. And here this 2f1 is actually the hypergeometric function, that is the Gauss hypergeometric function, and this is defined as a series. Actually it is a Gauss hypergeometric series, and this is defined as a series alpha a alpha k beta k by gamma k is raised to k by k factor, where this alpha k is called the shifted factorial or the Spokamer symbol. And I will explain that what it is. In fact, here if you have 2f1 instead of z, if you have 1, then you have a result in terms of gamma functions with this real part of gamma minus alpha minus beta greater than 0. So what is this Spokamer symbol? Spokamer symbol is nothing or shifted factorial or this factorial function. In the book of Renville, it is mentioned as factorial function, and in many books like Special Functions for Applied Scientists or other books of Kilbass, Saigo, they use it as Spokamer symbol or a shifted factorial function. All are the same function, and you are the definition is A Spokamer n. Or a n is a factorial n is a times a plus 1 times etc. a plus n minus 1. And where for conventionally we take a of 0 is 1. And this Spokamer symbol has connections with the gamma functions also. So you can see that also. Gamma of a plus n by gamma of a is actually a Spokamer n. In that way, there is relation with the gamma function also. So this series here is converges absolutely in the region absolute value of z less than 1, and for real part of gamma minus alpha minus beta greater than 0. And in this relations, in the Saigo fractional integral operators and the Skober fractional integral operators, by a suitable substitution, we can go back to the, by a substitution here, we can go back to the Skober fractional integral operator. And by a substitution here, we can go back to the Riemann-Lowell fractional integral operator. So that is the advantage of this results. So when you put delta equal to minus gamma in this Saigo fractional operators, equation 6 and 7, this one, you will end up with the classical Riemann-Lowell fractional integrals. Okay, and when you put delta equal to 0 minus in equation 6 and 7, we will get the Skober fractional integral operators. So this is the particular case. So this is somewhat the generalization of the Riemann-Lowell fractional integral. So these are generalized, we can call it as generalized Riemann-Lowell fractional operators. This Skober as well as the Saigo operators are generalized Riemann-Lowell fractional operators. Okay. Now, I don't want to explain more fractional integrals, and there are so many fractional operators as well as fractional integrals derivatives defined in these days. So many people are defining many fractional integrals and derivatives. But it is necessary to you to know how to use these fractional integrals and derivatives in our functions or the functions which we have in our use. Okay, so this is my next attempt is to show how these fractional operators are used in our results. So for that, let me give integral transform developed by Kretzel. In 1975, Kretzel introduced a transform called Kretzel transform. In literature, it is called as Kretzel transform. And this Kretzel transform is actually defined here. Integral 0 to infinity is a rho nu xt f of t dt. And this has a kernel function, is a rho nu xt. And this is a rho nu x is defined here in integral 0, in equation 11, as integral 0 to infinity raised to nu minus 1 e raised to minus t raised to rho minus x t raised to minus 1. You just see this This integral cannot be solved by using any ordinary techniques of integration. You cannot use integration by parts. So what you are going to do is, to solve this type of integrals, we will be using Mellin transform technique. There will be a transform, transform called Mellin transform. We use that transform, integral transform, to solve these type of integrals to obtain a closed form solution of this. So we can use that and obtain a closed form solution. That I will explain, but before that, what I have done is, I have generalized this, and this is actually, this transform was a generalization of the Mayer transform, as well as the Laplace transform with the special cases. So by using a pathway idea, what I did is, in 2009, I generalized this Kretzel function, or Kretzel function. This I call as Kretzel function. This equation number 11, I call it as Kretzel function. And I generalize this to a more general integral, where this will be a particular case. So I generalize this and obtained a generalized Kretzel function. And here, this generalization has two forms. That is something like a finite form as well as an infinite form. Why? It is because of the properties in physics, what we require for a cutoff case. If you are considering a cutoff case, you can use this type of an integral. And if you are having an infinite case or infinite tail case, you can consider this equation number 14. So this we call it as type 1 generalized Kretzel function. Why we call it as type 1? It is because of the structure sitting here. Is a generalized type 1 beta form here. So that is the difference. Actually, this you can consider as a cutoff case, because it will go from zero to a finite quantity. So that is why we call it as type 1 case. And this is set rho nu alpha plus x is the type 2 case. So now this can be generalized, or this can be, we can apply this fractional operators on this type of functions. How we can use it? So before that, what is specialty of this? As you take the limit as alpha tends to 1 in this function, or as in this function, when you put limit alpha tends to 1 minus in this, you are going to get this particular function in L1, or the Kretzel function in L1. And similarly, as alpha tends to 1 plus, you are going to get the same function. So this is the specialty of this. So this is done by using the pathway model introduced by Mathai in 2005. I will explain about the pathway model later. Anyhow, let us see how it comes. See, this is what I was saying. So this, as alpha tends to 1, this quantity will go to an exponential function. And so we can generalize this as limit alpha tends to 1, or this alpha tends to 1 plus, you are going to get the Kretzel function. So in particular, if you put again further rho equal to 1 and x equal to t square by 4, then you can establish a relation between the modified Bessel function or the McDonald function with the generalized Kretzel function. That is what we can do. Okay. So these are our fractional transforms. We can call it as fractional transforms. Why? Because it evaluates the fractional order. It can handle fractional order terms or fractional order derivatives. We can handle by using these type of transforms. Anyhow, this theorem, I'm not going to show the proof of all these things, because may be boring for you, because these all are available in the literature. These results are available in the paper of myself and Kilbas in 2009. You can refer to that, generalized Kretzel function. The title of the paper is generalized Kretzel function. So here we have established a relation connecting the Riemann-Lovell fractional integral operator and the generalized Kretzel function. And you can see that the Riemann-Lovell fractional integral of a generalized Kretzel function yields a generalized Kretzel function for both the alpha less than 1 case as well as the alpha greater than 1 case. See, actually here we have two cases. This is for alpha less than 1 and for alpha greater than 1. So that is why you can see it for alpha less than 1 and for alpha greater than 1. So this for two cases, you can see that it yields the Riemann-Lovell fractional integral yields a generalized Kurzweil function itself. Similarly, so this is a proof of that, how it came. Because by using the power function formula for a Riemann-Lovell fractional exponential function, the Riemann-Lovell fractional integral of an exponential function is this, and by using this result, we can establish this. Okay. So now, obviously, as alpha tends to 1, we can get the corresponding results for the standard Kurzweil function. So that is what we have established here. Here is a generalized one, and as limit, as you take the limit, you will get the result for the standard. This is the result for the standard Kurzweil function. Okay. Now, in the same way, we have fractional derivatives also. For Riemann-Lovell fractional derivatives also, we can establish the results. It also yields the same thing. The fractional derivative of Riemann-Lovell fractional derivative of the generalized Kurzweil function yields a generalized Kurzweil function. So this proof is also similar to that in the previous case. Just we have to interchange the derivative and integral sign, because it is possible because of this uniform convergence here of this in the particular integral, and we can get the results. Okay. So just I want to show that these results can be made like this. So what, and this is a composition of both the Riemann-Lovell fractional integral as well as derivative of the generalized Kurzweil function. And this composition, can you can see that this yields again the Riemann-Lovell fractional integral, generalized Kurzweil function. Okay. So these are also the results like that. I think the time is moving. So next, by using this generalized Kurzweil function, in similar to that of the generalized transform, Kurzweil transform, I have made a generalized transform of this Kurzweil, and I call it as P transform. This was introduced by myself in 2011, and this is the transform where the kernel function is this function. I have introduced one more additional parameter beta to incorporate many things in physics also. That is why I made this part in generalized Kurzweil function, it is minus 1. This integral and this integral part, you are having e raised to minus x, y raised to minus 1. So this is for the Kurzweil function. That is why I used here x minus x, y raised to minus 1. So here, that is why we restricted it to e raised to minus x, y raised to minus 1. But in general case, we can have many parameters there, and we have practical applications in making that into a general form. So for that, we have made a generalization for that, and we have made this. And is a row where this integral transform called P transform, and we, since it is, we are using for alpha less than 1, we are having this as a type 1 P transform. And for where the kernel function is this one, is a rho beta nu alpha minus, we have e raised to this integral, integral 30. I'm not going to read that. Okay, this is for alpha less than 1. And here, this e raised to minus x, y raised to minus beta, this you have to note. And also note this one, integral 0 to infinity, 1 by 1 minus alpha raised to 1 by rho, y raised to nu minus 1, 1 minus 1 minus alpha, y raised to rho, whole raised to 1 by 1 minus alpha. So this particular structure, you have to know this structure, because I will be explaining what is the practical application of this particular integral in astrophysics. So, okay. So let us see the next type, type 2 P transform. Type 2 P transform is given in equation 31, and its kernel function is at rho beta nu alpha plus is given as in equation 32. Where these two transforms are defined in the space L nu r 0 infinity, consisting of the Lebesgue measurable complex valued functions f, for which this condition is satisfied. Okay. It's a separate special norm we are taking for this P transforms. It is similar to that which we take when we define H transform. There is transform called H transform. You may are familiar, you are heard about the H functions. So by using that, Kilbas have introduced a transform called H transform, and it is available, and the generalization of many transforms available in the literature. So H transform, for that also they use the same Lebesgue measurable complex valued function F, which with this now. Okay, now for this we already know what it is, because for the particular cases as beta equal to 1 and alpha tends to 1, you are going to get the generalized functions which I have made for alpha beta equal to 1. We will get the previous generalized Kurzweil function, and further again as alpha tends to 1 we will get the generalized Kurzweil transform or Kurzweil function or standard Kurzweil function. That is what we are getting here. Okay, so for more, when rho equal to 1 you are going to get the Mayer transform. So I am not going to explain that. So now we can see how a transform, integral transform, is related to fractional operators. So you can apply for that, for applying a left sided Zygo operator of a power function, for applying the Zygo fractional operator to a P transform, we need the result for the power function of a left sided Zygo operator of a power function. That is what we have proved here. So this result gives the Zygo fractional operator of a power function T raised to lambda, and we will get this. So by using this result, we can find the P transform, the Zygo operator of a P transform. That is what we have proved here. This is a proof of that power function. So it's again a corollary for that. So here you can see the Zygo operator of a P transform yields an H transform with H2, 2, 3, 4. And here it's for the type 2 P transform. I'm not going to explain all these things because it's useless to simply explain this if you are not aware of all these things. I just wanted to show that these things can be applied to this type of P transforms or integral transforms which developed by many people. Okay, so this is a proof for that. And some corollaries, by using the corollaries we can get the results for left Riemann-Lovell fractional operators, after Pauber fractional operators. All these things can be developed by giving particular values, because we have already mentioned that by putting delta equal to minus gamma we will get the Riemann-Lovell from Zygo. So similarly, you will get the Pauber also. Delta equal to 0 minus, you will get the Pauber. So that all things you already know. Okay, so these are all results like that. So fractional, so the Riemann-Lovell fractional operator and P transform. So this this also the same thing in this as in the previous case. I'm not going to explain these things. Okay, now the key factor is that I was mentioning how these integrals were related to physics or astroparticle physics. So you all know the sun, the star near to us, the energy production in star like sun is by using the thermonuclear reactions taking place in them, and you know that it's a fusion reaction. Suppose in a fusion reaction, suppose two particles are colliding with each other. What is a fusion reaction? When two particles are colliding with each other, you will get a third and fourth particle with some energy. This is what we call the fusion reaction. So this can be symbolized like this. Particle of type 1 and type 2 are colliding, and you will get a particle of type 3 and type 4 plus some energy. This is what the reaction usually means. And how this reaction comes? This reaction rate probability is the probability that two particles, suppose you consider an ensemble or consider a unit volume of the space in the sun where the nuclear fusion is taking place. It is in the crust. The nuclear fusion is taking place in the sun in the crust. So in that, you consider a unit volume of that. And if you are, there is a probability that the two particles confined in that unit volume should react with each other. Then that is called the reaction rate probability. So this is called the reaction rate probability, integral 0 to infinity f of v sigma v BdV is the reaction rate probability per particle pair. Okay, what is the major factor which affects the reaction rate? It is the relative velocity of the particle, that is the particle, when the particles are colliding with each other, the velocity with which they are colliding, as well as the reaction cross section. Cross section means the part of the area where these particles are colliding. So these are the major factors which affects their reaction rate. So usually, if you consider a non-resonance, there are two types of reaction: non-resonant as well as resonant. Resonance means the probability of a, or the property of a system to oscillate at high amplitude in a given frequency. That is called resonance. Resonance means there is a vibrations when you, then the particles are colliding. If there is no vibration, then we consider it as non-resonant. So this is just simply we are assuming that there is no vibrations when the particles are colliding. In that case, we have to use a reaction cross section in this form. So instead of the sigma V, V and E are related with some expression half MV is equal to E. So by using that, we can give a relation to these things, and we can find an expression in terms of E also. So this is, if you consider the non-resonant reaction, then this is the reaction cross section, and the Maxwell-Boltzmann, if you consider there is no, the pressure, temperature, etc. are constant, that is, there is no pressure, temperature, or they are all in a constant way, or they are equal. If there is a hydrostatic equilibrium, then we usually consider a Maxwell-Boltzmann velocity distribution, which is given in equation number 64. Now, when you substitute these two, you are going to get the reaction rate probability integral. Okay, so this is that what I was saying. When you substitute all these things, you are going to get the reaction rate probability integral in this form. So you can see that this is nothing but the Kretschel, the form of a Kretschel transform, not the Kretschel function, but in the Kretschel function, you are having a minus 1 here, but here the x is raised to minus half. So it's not the Kretschel function. So you can make it to a Kretschel function. So for that, it is only the assumption that there is a hydrostatic equilibrium in that unit volume. But usually it is not like that. There is deviation from the Maxwell-Boltzmann situation. There is no hydrostatic equilibrium. If there is no hydrostatic equilibrium, we cannot use this. Instead, we have to use another velocity distribution which can cover the Maxwell-Boltzmann as a particular case. So we have to use a new or generalized velocity distribution. For that, what I did is I created a new velocity distribution using a model called pathway model, which I was mentioning earlier. So if you use the pathway model, so before that, let me introduce what is pathway model. Pathway model was introduced in 2005 by Mathai. And by this model, you can go from your switch between, you can switch between three functional forms, the generalized type 1 beta model to a generalized type 2 beta model and to a generalized gamma model. So what are the models here? This 66 is a generalized type 1 beta model. This is a 67 is a generalized type 2 beta model, and this 68 is a gamma model. So as alpha tends to 1, these models will go to this, or alpha or Q. Here is Q. Q tends to 1. You are going to get this generalized type 1 and type 2 beta models will go to the generalized gamma model. So by using this, we can obtain a generalized velocity distribution or pathway velocity distribution. So this is the behavior of the pathway for various values of Q. For alpha tends to 1, for Q equal to 1, you are getting the standard form, and many non-equilibrium or chaotic situations are explained by this form. See, there is cutoff. When you are going taking the case alpha less than 1, you can see the cutoff here. Initially, I was telling about the cutoff case. This is the cutoff. So you can see various cutoffs happening here. Here there is no cutoff, it goes up to infinity. So for the general type 1 case, this is the type 1 case, and this is the type 2 case. So by using this, you can obtain a velocity distribution instead of Maxwell-Boltzmann, and you can replace this, and what you are going to get is the extended thermonuclear reaction rate probability integral is here in equation 70, and the integral to be evaluated is this. So let us give particular values to this and make it simple. If you make it simple, the integral to be evaluated will be of this form, equation 72. Now, what can you see any specialty? You can give replace this minus half by a rho, and you are getting the generalized the kernel function which I have introduced, the kernel function of the P transform. This is nothing but the kernel function of the P transform. Now, how it is evaluated? It is by using the Mellin transform technique. So you consider this as a product of two integrable functions. Neelam, can I take some more minutes? Hello?
Yes, sir. You can take a few more minutes.
Okay. I'm just concluding.
Yes.
Okay. So you are having two functions, integrable functions. If you are having two integrable functions, you can apply Mellin convolution property. So what is the Mellin transform? Integral 0 to infinity x raised to s minus 1 f of t dt or f of x dx. X raised to s minus 1 f of x dx is the Mellin transform. So here you are taking the Mellin transform each of these functions, individual functions, and the integral, the Mellin transform of this function is nothing but the product of the Mellin transform of these two functions. So that is what the property is. So you are finding the Mellin transform of MF3 is Mellin transform of F3 is the product of Mellin transform of F1 and the Mellin transform of F2. That is what we use the Mellin convolution property. It is by using the Mellin convolution property. Okay, so thus we will get this, and taking the inverse Mellin transform, you are going to get the function, the original function. So you will be getting a function in the Mellin Barnes. This is a Mellin Barnes type integral, and this can be written in the form of a H function, and thus you will get the integral in the form of an H function, where an H function is a Mellin Barnes type integral with the product of gammas. Okay. So since there is no time, I have no time to explain this, what is an H function, all these things. Anyhow, you can refer this Mathai 1993 book or 19 Mathai Hobold 2008 book for this H function and G function, or Saxena Mathai and Saxena 1973 book also. So by using this, for particular cases, 1 by rho, if 1 by rho is an integer, you will get with an G function. And in physics, you can see that it is rho is 1 by 2. Instead of beta, here it is rho. So rho is 1 by 2, so you will get this function. So there is a clear-cut straightaway relation between the reaction rate probability integral as well as the kernel function of that transform. So anyhow, this is for further studies on that reaction rates. We can give the interpretations for this parameter which we are using. And also, we are showing that alpha is, what is alpha and how this alpha is related to this energy. That is what I have explained here. So for various values of alpha, we are showing this reaction rate probability integrals and the temperatures, for various temperatures, what it will be. This is what, and the fusion window for the extended reaction rate probability integral, that is also explained here. Okay. So there is a clear cut applications of this. So if this is the standard case, this is a standard case, standard reaction rate probability integrals when you use, but if you generalize it, you are getting a number of windows for this extended reaction rate probability integral. So this, you are having various fusion windows available. Okay. So these are some of my publications. Anyhow, thank you very much for your patient listening. I just want to show some of the applications of this fractional calculus in astrophysics. And this is when I received the Young Scientist Award from Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam. And thank you very much for your patient listening.
Thank you, sir. Are there any questions from the participants? So I have received one question over my mobile. Is asking that, what do you mean by the paradoxical aspects?
Paradoxical aspects of?
Yes, of fractional derivatives.
Okay. That is what Leibniz was saying.
Yeah.
The paradox means something which we are not proved at that time. So paradoxical aspects are many because we have not yet given a proper interpretation for this fractional order derivative or integral in a particular physical situation. That is a main disadvantage of this fractional calculus. We are introducing an additional parameter by saying that we can generalize this, but in clear ways we have to explain that. If we can explain that, then this paradoxical aspect will be removed. We can explain that in clear ways. That is the only disadvantage, I think, in this fractional calculus. And that is why various fractional operators are being developed. So to make more clear what is actually happening. I hope the doubt has been cleared. I don't know whether it's clear.
Yes, I also want to make a point here.
Yeah.
Regarding this, that when it was introduced, there was a lack of understanding that time.
Yes.
Of course, with the moving time and so much applications present, fractional calculus has marked its way along.
Yes.
So probably
there are in fractals, I think there are clear cut interpretations for this fractional derivatives, and by using the numerical techniques they have shown many results how it is related or how it is interpreted, how the parameter is interpreted, that we can clearly say.
Yes, sir. Are there any further questions from the participants? Then in that case,
okay.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for giving an opportunity. Thank you, Neelam, and your institute for giving me an opportunity for showing my results and sharing some experience of myself to the wonderful audience. Thank you, audience, for the patient listening. And if you have any queries, you can ask me or you can email me or call me. If you are having any collaborative results, you can have group collaborations also. All are welcome. Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Neelam, for...